Hi all, welcome to Smart Catalyst, 26 February 2019. Today we will be discussing these 8 topics. The first one is related with the weather forecast for India this year released by SkyMet. The second is related with the 4th Global Digital Health Partnership Summit organized by India. The third one is related with India's participation in Russia-India-China meet. The fourth article is related with the recent violence in Arunachal Pradesh. The fifth is related with ICJ's verdict on Chagos Archipelago. The sixth is related with forest fire in Bandipur National Park. The seventh one is related with the new CSO report on employment created in formal sectors. The last article is related with the banks opting for repo rate in new external benchmark rate policy. Let's move to the first article. A private weather forecaster, SkyMet, has recently released a report. In that report, it has cited that El Nino has been weakening, and because of this factor, 2019 is unlikely to be a drought year. El Nino is a geographical phenomenon. El Nino is caused by the warming of waters along the Peru coast. During normal years, the current along the Peru coast would be a cold current. And all climatological phenomena happening in Indian Ocean region is dependent on this flow of waters. Important climate phenomena in the Indian Ocean region, like the monsoon winds, they are based on the cold currents flowing near the surface of Peru. But during El Nino year, due to various factors, the cold current is replaced by a warm current. And this warm current creates disequilibrium in climate of Indian Ocean region, thereby disrupting the monsoon winds coming to India. Many of the Indian droughts are related with El Nino in previous years. The research undertaken by SkyMet, the SkyMet study has found that El Nino has got weakened, and because of this weakened El Nino, 2019 will have normal rainfall compared to the previous years. The second article is related with India's hosting of 4th Global Digital Health Partnership Summit along with WHO. India is one of the leading countries in the world offering cheaper and affordable healthcare facilities. This is the main reason for India being the leader in medical tourism. Apart from that, the digital technologies front, India is the leader. And now this digital and health are being interlinked in the new Global Digital Health Partnership undertaken by Ministry of Health and WHO. The importance of health in providing sustainable development to the people is well understood based on the Sustainable Development Goal number 3. The goal number 3 speaks about good health and well-being, and it mentions that every country should ensure healthy lives and promote well-being for all at all ages. Though India is offering affordable medical facilities, infusion of digital governance would cut down the cost of medical facilities. And this is the reason for organizing this Global Digital Health Partnership. The summit is organized by an organization known as Global Digital Health Partnership. Global Digital Health Partnership is an alliance between various governments of the countries and WHO. This GDHP aims at providing proper usage of evidence-based digital technologies, thereby reforming the health systems existing in different developing countries. The GDHP was inaugurated in the year 2018, and the Australia had provided the secretariat services for the GDHP for the first 18 months. The third article is related with the participation of our External Affairs Minister in RIC meet. This RIC meet, Russia-India-China trilateral meet, is happening after the Pulwama attack, and it has gained more significance in diplomatic circles. The 16th Russia-India-China trilateral meet is about to start in this Wednesday in the Chinese city of Wuhan. The RIC meet gains more importance because of its timing. It is happening after the Pulwama attack. And also, recent condemnation given by China over Pulwama attack, China didn't name the Jaish-e-Mohammed terrorist organization. And even in United Nations Security Council, while all other permanent and temporary members criticized Pakistan for its state-sponsored terrorism, China has been staying neutral, supporting either sides. And it is widely understood that China is considering Pakistan to be its all-weather friend. And now, New Delhi has an uphill task in persuading China to support India's demand in declaring Pakistan-based Maulana Masood Azhar a terrorist under United Nations norm. At the behest of Pakistan, China has blocked several attempts undertaken by India, France, UK and US to name or to sanction Maulana Masood Azhar under UN Resolution 1267. Maulana Masood Azhar is not only the chief of JEM, he has also got some credible links with Al-Qaeda, global terrorist organization. Almost all the three countries of this trilateral meet have experiencing the menace of terrorism. Russia is experiencing the menace of Chechenian terrorism. China is experiencing the terrorism arising among the Uyghur Muslims. India from Pakistan infused terrorism in Jammu and Kashmir. So terrorism becomes an important talk point when these three countries are meeting. It has been the case for the previous years. Now, with increasing pressure on China, it is expected that China would support India's claim on declaring Maulana Azhar as a terrorist under UN norms. In this context, it is pertinent for us to know the background of the RIC forum. RIC forum is a trilateral grouping of Russia, India, China, and it has been meeting annually since the year 2002, and the 2019 marks the 17th meeting of RIC. And this trilateral meeting acts as a subset under the Shanghai Cooperation Organization. Russia, India and China occupy around 50% of Asia's landmass. When the security architecture in the region is undergoing a devious change, it is important, it becomes crucial that the large countries of the Asia come together to discuss about security. Apart from the security aspects, they also got impact on economy and political stakes in the region. This trilateral organization acts as a minilateral body to provide blueprint for the global multilateral bodies, thereby impinging on proper global governance. The fourth article is about the recent violence that has erupted in the state of Arunachal Pradesh. Arunachal Pradesh government has provided permanent residentship to six tribal population living in the state, and this has incited violence from other majority tribal groups. Recently, a joint high power committee of Arunachal Pradesh government had provided recommendation to grant permanent resident certificates to six Adivasi communities in Arunachal Pradesh. The six members are Diori, Gorkha, Mishing, Moran and Sonowal Kachari communities. These communities are not native to the Arunachal Pradesh state, but they are living in the Namsai and Changlang districts of Arunachal Pradesh, and they are considered to be the migrants from the nearby Assam. And they had been issued with the PRCs in 1990-93, but they were subsequently revoked due to various other reasons. Okay, Arunachal Pradesh is a predominantly tribal state, and providing permanent residentship certificates to the other tribals not belonging to the common stock of Arunachal Pradesh has created an irritant among the majority tribal groups dwelling in Arunachal Pradesh. Also, by providing permanent resident certificates to these six tribal people, the requirement of inner line permit has been quashed. The majority tribal people feel that the quashing of ILP, that is inner line permit, will create some problems for their cultural identity. These reasons have led to the violence in Arunachal Pradesh. Yesterday, International Court of Justice has given an advisory opinion asking UK to hand over Chagos Archipelago to Mauritius. Chagos Archipelago was wrested from Mauritius by the UK government in 1965. Second half of 20th century witnessed decolonization happening in various parts of the world, and one such was the decolonization of Mauritius from the rule of British. But the process of decolonization in Mauritius Island was not complete. In 1965, Chagos Archipelago, which has been the part of Mauritius for years together, was separated from Mauritius. And this separation of Chagos Archipelago became a point of contention between Mauritius and United Kingdom in the decades followed by. And the Chagos Archipelago gains more strategic importance because it is located almost in middle of the Indian Ocean region. British government has granted this Chagos Island to American government, and the American government has established Diego Garcia's naval base there. By these factors, it becomes a strategically important region. Mauritius appealed in International Court of Justice against the move of United Kingdom. And now, ICJ, in an advisory opinion, note that it is not a judgment, it is an advisory opinion. In this advisory opinion, it mentioned that Britain has an obligation to end its administration of the Chagos Archipelago. In the opinion, ICJ also mentioned that the continued administration of Britain over Chagos Archipelago has led to the partial completion of decolonization process. This is seen as a remnant of this continued administration of Britain in Chagos Archipelago is seen as a remnant of ugly colonialism still prevailing in the third world countries. Apart from being a bilateral issue, this case has also got wider ramifications. It questions the legacy of colonialism and the legitimacy of pre-independence agreements that has been signed between the colonizer and the colonies. These two questions are raised as a part of discussions over this particular verdict by ICJ. Also, after separating the Chagos Archipelago from Mauritius, the Chagosians, the people, the native inhabitants of Chagos Islands were also ousted from the island. And the future of Chagos Island, whether to join the Britain or whether to join Mauritius, has to be made by people who once inhabited in Chagos Archipelago. Apart from creating ripples in international arena, it has also got some ramification for India. in Kulbhushan Jadhav case, which is based on judgment provided by Pakistan's military court, we can also expect an advisory opinion. But advisory opinions are not legally binding, though they come from ICJ with the power of United Nations over and above ICJ. Still, many countries have violated the advisory opinions given by ICJ. One example is Israel violating the advice given by ICJ in 2003. The sixth article is about the recent forest fire that has destroyed more than 2,500 acres of forest land in Bandipur National Park. Bandipur Tiger Reserve and National Park is located in the state of Karnataka along the crucial and critical Western Ghats region. And the recent forest fires has destroyed more than 2,500 acres of forest cover. This has created various ecological and ecosystem problems. And this is not a one-off instance. The forest fire that has happened in Bandipur is not a one-off instance. Recent years, we have been witnessing increased number of forest fires in India. This has been also supported by the studies undertaken by Forest Survey of India under its biennial Indian State of Forest Report 2017. The study indicates that almost every year, we are losing around 440 crore rupees due to forest fires. And more than 50% of forests in India are vulnerable to forest fire. The states of Odisha, Chhattisgarh, Madhya Pradesh, Uttarakhand, they are more vulnerable, and the number of incidents, more than thousands happening every year, indicates the level of vulnerability these states are facing over forest fires. The seventh article is about the new report released by Central Statistical Organization based on EPFO and ESIC data, claims that more than 2 crore jobs have been created in the past 18 months. In the wake of recent criticism over lack of employment opportunities being created in India, the government has been using various methodologies to provide data about the level of employment being created in the country. And one such is by providing data on EPFO and ESI registration. EPFO is Employee Provident Fund Organization and ESI is Employment State Insurance Corporation. And ESIC applies to all establishment which has more than 20 employees and employees earning more than 21,000 per month. EPFO includes, the Employee Provident Fund Organization includes all establishments with more than 20 members and all employees earning more than 15,000. And the data is being collated by Central Statistical Organization, and according to this data, 2 crore jobs have been created in the country in the past 16 months. The number of memberships in ESIC has increased by 1.96 crore between the period of September 2017 to September 2018. In the case of EPFO, the employment generation in December 2018 was 7.16 lakhs. Also, between the period of September 2017 to December 2018, EPFO had seen the increased subscriber base of 72.32 lakhs. The report also cites that the data collated in this particular report indicates the level of formal employment being created in the country. The last article is related with the proposed new credit regime. This regime is known as external benchmark rate, and it has four benchmarks. Of them, the banks are choosing repo rate over other benchmarks. With varying economic conditions prevailing in the country, central bank has been evolving its loan pricing regimes. In 1994, we had prime lending rate mechanism. In 2003, we followed benchmark prime lending rate. From 2010, we followed the base rate. Now we are using this MCLR, marginal cost of funds based lending rate. And now recently RBI has proposed to provide external benchmark linked rate in order to provide improved monetary transmission in the country. This external benchmark rate is based on the rates of repo rate, treasury bill rate or corporate deposit rates. The banks can choose from either of these four rates, and based on that they can fix their spread and charge interest rate from their customers. There was a deep dissent among the bankers, citing that the treasury bill and corporate deposit rates are volatile and they will cause some hindrance to the credit growth in the country. Now, most of the commercial banks have chosen to stick with repo rate as the external benchmark rate. This external benchmark rate mechanism is different from MCLR based mechanism in one context. This external benchmark rate has an advantage. The advantage is that the spread under the new method will remain unchanged throughout the tenure. The repo rate is not a static phenomenon. The repo rate will be changed based on the level of inflation in the economy by the Monetary Policy Committee. With the repo rate being consistently changed, the spread will remain same, providing stability to the customer. The spread under the new method will remain unchanged throughout the tenure. This is an advantageous position for the customer. but the spread might increase based on the credit assessment of the particular customer. Thank you.